everyone. Thanks for coming. My name is Adrian St. Jarens. I was one of the CG supervisors on Beauty and the Beast alongside Julian Hutchins at Framestore's Montreal office under the supervision of Kyle McAuliffe on the client side and VFX supervisor Richard Hoover in Montreal. So just a bit about myself. I started my career in London and then made my way over to Singapore where I lived 5 years and eventually made the journey over to Montreal. So due to some visa delays, we ended up arriving in the middle of winter, so going from 30 degrees in Singapore to minus 30 degrees in Montreal. Pretty intense shock to the system, I must admit. Luckily, I was put straight away on Beauty and the Beast and turned out to be an amazing project, an amazing team. Altogether, it was a very smooth and enjoyable ride. I wonder if it has something to do with the singing and music that we were listening to in dailies. So I'm going to start by showing you a breakdown reel of some of the work that we did. So altogether, we did a total of 750 shots, roughly, with 350 artists across the Montreal and the London offices at Framestore. The bulk of the work that we did in the movie was on the characters that you're seeing there, the household staff. So this talk is going to go through the challenges that we face in building these characters, both technical and creative, and also ensuring that at the same time, we didn't upset anyone that was already in love with the original cell animated characters. One of the pieces of the puzzle that I think made our work successful on Beauty and the Beast was the fact that there was a lot of planning ahead of time. The pre-production phase was invaluable to us being able to deliver the quality of the characters that we did. So a lot of that's down to Sarah Greenwood, the production designer, and Bill Condon, the director. They made sure that there was a consistent and clear direction throughout the project from the start to the finish. And that started with concept. So a lot of the inspiration for the interior of the castle and for the design of the characters in it was from French Rococo. So you can see the amount of ornate detailing that they have in these images. And that's very obvious in the context of the interior of the castle and the characters. The Wallace collection in London had some of these ornate period Rococo pieces and really influenced a lot the design of the characters. You can see a clear connection here between some of these objects and the way our characters look in the movie. It was great to have this Wallace collection in London, so the London team was actually able to go and visit and look at these objects firsthand to understand how the materials were. So from this, we received our first set of concepts. So it was really when we got to meet the characters that we were going to be working on. Obviously, we knew them from the original cartoon, but it was great to see kind of the direction they were going to take in this movie. So we had Lumiere, Cogsworth, Mrs. Potts, Chip, Garderobe, Frou-Frou, Cadenza, Chapeau, and Plumette. So these are some of the hero characters that we had to build. We also made more props that were in the rest of the movie, and some of them that actually had to come to life for the final battle sequence. So with this concept, we were able to do an initial build for some of the key characters to help define how they're going to move, to define their characters. There was an initial kickoff with Bill and Sarah to discuss the general aspects and ideas for each of them. And from there, we started creating small vignettes to our animation tests to try to flesh those out and see how they'd work in practice. So here you can see Chip and Potts. Potts, the kind of worried mother and loving, and Chip, the young, energetic kid who likes to skateboard around on his plate. So this idea, you know, happened very early on, and it stuck through the rest of the project. We had some animators do some tests to try to figure out how they can use skateboarding moves for Chip. So I see him doing an ollie, a little grind, another grind, cruising around. Don't know why Justin Bieber was chosen as a as a reference for skateboarding, but that's what the animators chose. And then either a hard flip or a 360 flip, I'm not entirely sure. But you know, it was fun for animators to be able to play with this for Chip throughout. For Lumiere, an initial test, you know, we have him transforming from a candelabra to his kind of bipedal self. The design changed quite a bit from here, but it you know, already showed kind of his flamboyant personality and where we're going to have to head with him. Chapeau, he was kind of the muscle of the team. So early on, trying to see how he'd be able to fight. He kind of shines near the end of the movie during the final battle sequence using these types of moves. You can see here the design's quite different to what's in the movie as well. So from the concepts, the prop designers were able to actually build physical maquettes of all the characters that we subsequently created CG versions of. So this was helpful for quite a few people, for the actors, for the DOP, and for us. For the actors, it gave them an idea of the eyeline, where they should be looking, the weight of the characters, because these things were actually made out of wood and metal, and also the design of the characters that they're actually acting with. For the DOP, they could actually place the maquettes in the scene and light them the way they wanted to before removing them. And for us, it gave us great lighting reference and obviously the basis for our CG model builds. So the fact that the maquettes were made so early on and they were so well detailed really helped us tremendously. So here you can see an example of a plate with the maquette of, or the physical built objects of Mrs. Potts and Chip. So we'd receive a version of each shot with these maquettes in it, and then also a version without them. This was going to be our base plate to add our CG characters to. And then using the reference and also some, you know, gray and chrome spheres, Macbeth charts, we were able to add our character to the scene and know that it fit really and reacted the way it should. They also built the larger characters that we had to build, so Cadenza and Garderobe. And in this case, they were both fully mechanized robots that had a motion control rig. They weighed over a ton, so they didn't actually shoot one with and without. They just left them in the plate. In some cases, we were able to keep the asset as it was in the plate, but oftentimes we just replaced it fully. This again was helpful for the actors, just to know where to look, and they'd have motion with the motion control rigs. They'd actually have these characters react to them. So even though this talks a bit more about characters, I'm just going to do a little quick point about the sets that we had and the environments that we built. The sets were really quite amazing. The scale of them, they were all like very large set. So in this image that you're seeing here, it's just that section at the top of the stairs that's actually like a CG replacement. The rest is actually the physical build of the set. So a lot of shots, we didn't have to do anything. It was just the plate as it was. But in the cases where we did have to do an extension, we had some really good reference imagery. And it really felt like we were just continuing the work of the prop makers, using the same, matching their gold paint, matching their stonework and everything, to ensure that it felt consistent with what they intended. So here you can see in the top right an image from the set, and then the main image is our CG build for the extension. So you can see we really went into a lot of detail to ensure that it worked and it would work as an extension of the sets. Here's some examples. So now that we had our sets and we had the maquettes, it was time to bring these characters to life. So I'll talk you kind of through some of the processes that we use to do this, how we build our characters, and then also specific challenges for some of our key characters, because they were also different. They all had their own unique issues. And then also, just as an example of a sequence that was well-planned and that paid off in the end, Be Our Guest. Talk to you a bit about that. So our character build process is consistent in Framestore. We always kind of follow the same methodology. In this case, we receive scanned data from ClearAngle. And we ingested that geometry and also the cameras that generated the photogrammetry. We basically keyframed the camera for each angle that was used to generate the scan, which permitted us to compare things one-to-one against the images that we received. We'd model in Maya and ZBrush, UV in Maya, texture in Mari and Photoshop, look dev in Arnold, and then do our rigging in Maya. So every character that went through this process, I'm going to show you Chapeau and specifically kind of how these different steps look. So this is the kind of imagery that we receive, so both polarized and unpolarized images. From this, we were able to create our camera and then match our geometry to these images to confirm that everything's working the way it should. And here you can see kind of a more standard turntable of the same finished asset. With the cameras lined up and the polarized images, we were able to project the polarized images as a base for our color map and start the texturing process. Again, you know, looking through all the same camera angles as what was used for photogrammetry. So here you can see the color map, specular, bump map, and then a set of masks. Each character, you know, we'd always separate out like the gold paint, the woods, all the types of detailing so that look dev had as much control as possible to really fine tune the materials. So texturing and look dev worked really closely just to ensure that they can create assets that would really match the reference that we received. So here you can see the finished chapeau in the look dev turntable. We also, you know, would look at things in different look dev environments to just confirm that the materials would work in different contexts. This is the type of submission that we would send to clients just to get approval on the characters with a little walk cycle to go along with it. As far as creating the inanimate version of these characters, the process that we followed was pretty straightforward, and it gave us an amazing starting point for the characters. The complicated part, one of the main issues was for rigging and animation, because we had to figure out how animation was going to emote anything from these characters that are so abstract. So, you know, each character had a very unique design and specific challenges. I'm going to go through four characters that had an interesting set of issues. that kind of just to give you an idea of the types of problems that we faced. So I'll start off with Cogsworth. From a build perspective, as I mentioned, it was relatively straightforward. Every other frame here is an RCG version, and every other frame from that is the actual picture of the thing that was built. So it gave us really a really good reference for what it should be. Here you can see the physical build, then our version of that. You can see it changed a little bit. I mean, it's for quite a few reasons. One is that we had to make sure that it was readable in dark lighting environments, and when it was too specular, too glossy, it was harder to read. We almost removed the specular highlight on his glass and kind of lifted some of the dark areas. What was specifically challenging for him was his rig. You know, he's a very rigid character. Like his body doesn't really lead to bending very much. He's got some obvious constraints, like the bits inside his belly as he rotates are going through him. But in a way, it was all right because the director didn't want us to make these characters too cartoony. Like the general note was that they should feel quite rigid, they should feel real. So for Cogsworth, that was okay, but there were still moments where he had to pick things up, he had to run around, and he needed to be flexible. So rigging and animation worked together very closely to try to work out how that would work. His legs, for example, you know, they had to move around and keep a specific shape as he was going. They're both front-facing and back-facing, so animation had a way of controlling them both in unison, but also separating them out if they needed to. One of the most complicated part of the rig was his face. The main reason for that is just because, like his mouth, for example, is a sundial, and how do you make a sundial like actually do shapes that are similar to a mouth. So animation actually did their own kind of test rigs, prototype rigs, before it went into rigging. And this for each character, it was something that was quite common to ensure that they had the full set of flexibility that they wanted, and that they'd be able to emote what was necessary between the characters. So here you can kind of see him in his final form in our look dev environment for client. And here's a little animation that kind of shows the types of expression that the animators were able to do with Cogsworth. I think in the end it was very successful. His eyebrows actually weren't part of the design until quite late. Some of the previous versions, his eyebrows weren't as dark as that, so you couldn't read them at all. But luckily, the decision was made to darken them, and so that really helped animators. He also had like small objects within his belly that he had to rip out and do stuff with, or sometimes they'd fall, which is a little challenging in itself. So Lumiere was another one of the main characters. He had a small face, and he was all made out of the same material. So the challenge with him was trying to figure out a way to read his expressions and what he's meant to convey. Look dev and texturing worked hard to figure out the right amount of patina around his eyes to kind of get the eyes to stand out from the rest of his face. And there was also an additional pass that was given the comp to kind of intensify that or to make it even more readable than it was. As a result of his face being so small, the animators really had to use his body language as much as possible to kind of convey his flamboyant nature. One of the challenges there is he obviously has candles that are pointing upwards, so there's only so many moves they could do. I had to always ensure that he was pointing his hands towards the top. This is quite common for all these characters. We had our animators film themselves for reference. But so the interesting thing with him is he obviously has his flames and also his jacket. So we wanted to automate as much as possible some of the pipeline steps as we move forward with his shots. So the way we did that is using Shotgun at Framestore. Whenever someone in the production team would approve a version, it would kick off the next step in the pipe. So by approving an animation play blast, we'd get a bake of that same animation. By approving that bake, we'd get a creature effects simulation on the jacket. So this would come through with like a default set of on the cloth sim, and artists were able to go in and tweak those values and save it so that whenever this process was kicked off again, it would use the modified version. And then by approving that, it kicked off the simulation on the flames. So usually at the beginning, we were actually approving these versions, but because the success rate was so high, in the end, we automated that and just automatically approved the effect sims. And then once all that was approved, it would go to lighting so they can add the pretty lights and make them look beautiful. So that process is something that we used for other candles in the show. Like we had some just candlesticks that were fighting at the end, and also some chandeliers. So the flame process was used across those. And then for CFX, Mrs. Potts had a little like feather at the in front of her. That was also an automated process that would get run on bake approval. Next up was Mrs. Potts. So Mrs. Potts, her biggest challenge was her design, actually. It was challenging because the decision was made early on to have her face on the side of the pot and not use her spout as a nose as it was in the original design. And I think for this reason, it made her less familiar to anyone who saw it. So it took a lot of time to kind of nail her look. The having the spout in the middle of her face from in the cartoon, they could cheat different angles and make sure that it didn't cause any issues. But in real 3D space, with the perspective, from tests that were done early on, it was clear that it looked quite odd to have this big spout in your face when you're looking on a close-up of Mrs. Potts. So, that was kind of the brief for her. And early on, she looked quite different. She had a lot of additional features on her face. She had a smaller mouth and a little bit more like shapes like around her eyes and her other features. She looked a little creepy at the time, and so there was a decision made to redesign her, and that's what's in the final movie as it is now. So we went through a reconcepting phase kind of late in the process, offering different options to build director. The idea was to simplify things as much as possible so you can clearly read her facial expression, so you wouldn't like confuse one of those design pieces as her mustache or whatever. And also ensuring that, we got Emma Thompson's kind of personality through the design. So in the end, this is the version that got approved. And you can see it's a bit more, we had to make sure that it was consistent with Chip, which it was. So slightly larger mouth, simpler lines. So from here, we went back into texturing and really spent a lot of time refining her material properties and getting her to feel like porcelain, because the maquettes that were built for both Chip and Mrs. Potts were actually made out of plastic. So the way light scattered through them was quite a bit different to what you would imagine from fine china. So we really looked into this deeply. Like we had our artists with little teacups at their desk, looking closely at the cracks and how it all worked. To end up with this look dev submission. The fact that we kind of veered a little bit away from the version that was physically built meant it was a little bit more complicated to compare, to look at the reference and compare to our version, especially when it was a very like backlit kind of context. But in the end, I think it was the right call because it made her look more real. So the other thing that was and this redesign phase that we spent time on was the fact that in that original design, you kind of felt like there was a face trapped in a teapot because of the amount of extrusion that was happening around her features. So in this later concept, it was decided to kind of have lines that move around her face and that don't affect the cracks quite as much. There's still a little bit of some shapes that actually affected the cracks a bit more, but it kind of gave her a little bit more of a 2D animation look on her face, and I think helped in her readability and made her feel a little bit less creepy. So the mouth and eyes were deformed using a complex setup of shrink wraps, custom deformers, and surface space rig mesh blend, so we could deform while keeping the volume of the pot. And the other facial features, like the eyebrows and dimples, were done using flat planes that shrink wrapped on the pot so they could slide around. So next we had Garderobe. So she was probably the most abstract of the characters that we had, and had a very complex and unique problem to solve, which was how do you make her face, which is made purely out of cloth, react as a mouth should. So that was kind of the basis of our challenge with her. Her original design, again, was slightly different. This was, the idea here was that there were two strings holding the top and bottom lip that would be moved around. It didn't stick around for too long because it was a little creepy. kind of looks like Audrey 2 from The Little Shop of Horrors. We kind of reconvened with Sarah and found a new design for her, which is what's in the movie today. And again, as I said, like trying to figure out how can we make her mouth react the way a normal human mouth would. So here we had reference of the actresses doing their voice overs, but we're able to analyze them and then try to see how cloth could do a similar type of set of motions, so we can actually lip sync and do what you would usually do with a character. So here's a breakdown of one of the shots with Garderobe. We used N-cloth to simulate her. And there's two kind of main, like what's interesting here, which is that we've added essentially a bottom lip that was a shadow. So the shadow that you're seeing there doesn't actually correspond to the upper lip. It's a separate piece of geometry that we would render a shadow pass separately, give it to comp so that you can dial it in. And it gave the ability to open her mouth, and so she can do O shapes and things like that. Her base sim worked well, but there was a lot of art direction of exactly how things should move. So per shot, there was a lot of custom setups that were necessary, especially like at one point she screams and kind of all all the cloth goes out of her mouth. All that stuff was custom built. And another interesting fact, just because of the lag that happens through the simulation, we actually had to offset the animation by a few frames so that the lip sync wouldn't break. So hopefully from what I was just discussing earlier, point is that it's, having this clear direction and decisions made early on really helped develop our characters, and the quality, I think, shows from those decisions that were that stuck from the beginning. So I'm going to another good example of planning early on that pays off is the Be Our Guest sequence. So I'll talk to you a bit about how that was put together. So Bill Condon like really decided to bring the best people to make this happen early on in the pre-production phase. He had choreographer Anthony Van Last do all the choreography for this sequence. He worked alongside Framestore on the third floor to previs the entire sequence. Every move was carefully planned. The actual dance moves themselves. I mean, Bill didn't want Lumiere to look like he was a perfectly trained dancer and wanted him to feel a little bit more casual. So they had a lot of dancers come in and do the same moves over and over again until they found the right balance of dancers. So the ones that were very classically trained, usually we didn't actually use their mocap data, and it was more the ones that were a little bit less classically trained that Bill responded well to. So from this previs, we got a set of cameras from the third floor that was fed into a techno dolly and brought into the set, which was basically an empty table with Emma Watson sat at the end and a big techno dolly that was doing all the camera moves that were necessary for the film. So Conan also brought in Jules Fisher and Peggy Eisenhower, that are Tony Award-winning theater lighting designers. And they were brought on board to light the background as if, and also the foreground, as if it was a theatrical musical score. So they were, you know, using their knowledge and what they did to bring it to the movie. So all you're seeing, all the lighting back there, is actually from the shoot itself. They even went as far as like trying to figure out how the caustics might go off of the elements that are in the that would be added as CG later on, and how it would affect the room to try to make it as believable as possible. You know, oftentimes for a lot of these shots we did use plate, but a lot of times also we had to replace with fully CG for some of the more complex shots, and also at times when the plate wasn't doing what was expected. And then in those times, the lighting designers would actually go over to Framestore in London and sit down with the lighters and our team to discuss how they would do things on stage, and also ensure that the animation of the lighting was in time with the music. Lighting was actually doing the animation of the lights. We also provided categorized light AOVs for comp so that they can tweak the timing a little bit if necessary further down the line. So, you know, the shots in the BR guest sequence kept getting larger and larger. Original Bill wanted everything to kind of feel constrained to the room and didn't want things to get out. But as you can see here, there's a couple shots that really needed to be more grandiose, and so he still had the physicality of the table to a certain degree, but became a bit more abstract as time went on. There was also, for the sequence, custom bundle rigs that were made for like sets of plates and cutlery and everything to help animation essentially deal with less amount of data. So they would get groups of props that they would be able to animate and offset things. In that sense. I think the sequence worked out well. It showcases our creature work and shows that the clear direction can kind of pay off. So that concludes my talk, and I'm open to any questions at this point, if anyone has any. You? How long was the what, sorry? It's a good question. I don't actually have the answer to that. I think it was at least a year, no more. The question was, how long is was the production time for the 750 shots? But I don't have the answer. Sorry. Yeah, there's some mics up here if you guys want to use them. That's your question. No, so the question was if we did the stuff for Beast. No, that was DD who worked on Beast. We really focused on the household staff. We had a couple shots that, you know, we had to interact with the Beast, or more the Beast had to interact with our characters. So we did a lot of cross, like weekly calls to figure out, you know, how that would work and send them some Alembic caches of our assets so that they could have him actually interact with the Beast's hair and everything. Hi.
Hi, so teapots have a long history in computer graphics, so I was curious if there are any interesting anecdotes you can share with Mrs. Potts during production.
The thing with her, as I said, it was just, her redesign happened quite late in the production, so it was a bit of a stressful moment when they decided to redesign her. But realistically, I mean, it's kind of what I mentioned already, to be honest.
So she was not built out of the Utah teapot.
No, unfortunately not. I wonder if the Renderman teapot is a Mrs. Potts this year. That'd be pretty cool. But
thank you.
There's. Hi.
Hi. So I have two questions, mm-hmm. and hopefully I'll remember them. So the first one was, how do you decipher between a notice for the wardrobe?
Yeah, go ahead. Right. Yeah.
It was decided to do green screen and then a facial rig over top of a physical object. Mm-hmm. And I remember you said it was specifically so they would have something to look at.
Yeah.
But I guess, how do you decide what will be CG and what will be prompt, and how does that help? I guess, like, is it a help or beneficial to the artist, or?
It was, I mean, I think Bill had originally hoped that for those shots, like where you saw Garderobe with the green screen on the face, that we would only be replacing the face portion of Garderobe. But as things kind of evolved, it turned out easier for us to integrate her in the scene if we just did a full CG replacement. So the decision kind of just happened naturally, to be honest, because we'd just be rendering the full version of her, mm-hmm. and then give Comp the ability to choose how to integrate it. And in the end, it made more sense to just track a CG version on top and place her in there.
Okay, thank you. And my second question, as far as modeling, mm-hmm. And I know you said you did Maya and ZBrush. Mm-hmm. The intricate pieces that resemble the Rococo, you know, the really, those intricate details. So is a base model done in Maya first and then transferred to ZBrush where you do all of that, you know?
Yeah, so the scan data would go straight into ZBrush to get retopologized, mm-hmm. and refined, and then go into Maya. So it was more through ZBrush than Maya.
Thank you so much.
Nice.
Hello.
Hey.
So you mentioned that, well, some of it was done in London, some of it was done in Montreal.
Yeah.
How much was done in one part, and were there difficulties syncing up, and what was the process you used?
So it was like a 50-50 split, pretty much. The way it was split up is we had our set of characters, and London had their set of characters. We were doing Mrs. Potts, Cadenza, Chip, Cuisinière, which I didn't talk too much about. And Chapeau, and then London was dealing with Lumiere, Cogsworth, and the other ones, basically. So in order to make that work, we had weekly calls, just catching up about the assets on a regular basis and sharing our problems, just to make sure that any animators that had problems with the characters we were building, we could fix them, and vice versa. As far as syncing and everything, Framestore does a lot of cross-site shows, so the process for actually syncing the data over worked pretty well. It's quite automatic.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks.
No worries.
Hi. For the animation part, did you do rigging for every character or manually set frame by frame?
Can you repeat the question?
Do you do the rigging for every character?
Yeah, we did rigging for every character, and every character had a really like specific setup, a very bespoke setup, because we couldn't do any reuse really, because you know one character has 8 arms and the other one has 2 legs and this and that. So I mean, Lumiere was the only one that was kind of a more traditional base rig because he had 2 legs and 2 arms. But every character had their own custom rig that was developed between animation and rigging. Okay.
So, is there the whole pipeline in each studio, or is it like broken up like modeling's in one area and rigging's in another?
It's the whole pipeline in both.
Cool.
Yeah, we had the same crew across both sites, so we could really bring a full character from beginning to end, and so could London.
Cool. You mentioned you use motion capture mm-hmm. for different characters.
Yeah.
If I can ask for the animators, did they use facial capture for reference from the actors?
No, we didn't have facial capture. What we did have is when the actors were recording their voice, we had cameras set up so that they could reference the actors, what they were doing when they were recording, but we didn't do actual facial capture for the show. I think for Beast they did, but not for these characters.
Quick question for production-wise, did you guys make maquettes for all of the characters prior to scan for approval from the client as the general pipeline, or was it more of a creative process where you guys simply scanned in like Lumiere, where you actually had the chandelier and then had ZBrush artists create it and then submit like iterations to the client?
So the maquettes were provided by client, actually. So they built them and sent it to us, asking us to kind of start there. Depending on the characters, I mean, then we went through the process of all the steps that I mentioned of building the model, the rig, and all that kind of stuff, and we'd send them back a turntable with the character walking around, and that was our way of getting approval from client that, you know, our interpretation, which often there wasn't much interpretation because we just matched what they gave us, but that, you know, that to get approval on the characters. As I said, like, some of them changed from the time where they built the maquette, especially Mrs. Potts. And Lumiere, they didn't build a version of him with two legs. They actually had a version of him as a candelabra. I don't have a picture on it of that right here, but, you know, at the beginning of the movie when he's like in candelabra form, stood next to Cogsworth, that's the maquette that we received for Lumiere.
Awesome. Thank you.
Cool. All right. Well, I guess I'll end it there. Thanks a lot for coming.